This is a lecture on mesh current method. Mesh current method is another systematic method of circuit analysis. So again, what's meant by systematic method is that there are steps to do, rules to obey, and then in general you end up with simultaneous equations to solve. So it's another type of systematic method. You know, we discussed node voltage method, which was the first systematic method of analysis that we went over this quarter, and this is just another type of method that you can use to solve circuits. So here are the steps involved. First, you define something called a mesh current, and we'll talk about what that is. And then after you have your mesh currents defined, there's two major steps, KVL along with Ohm's law. If you remember node voltage method, once you define currents at a node, you had two steps, which were KCL and Ohm's law. So here it's KVL instead of KCL. And then, like I said, the last step is you'll have some equations to solve. So let's learn this method through some examples. And we're going to start with this circuit right here. And you can see we just have voltage sources in this circuit. And the first thing we need to do anytime we do a problem using mesh current method is we need to define our meshes. So what a mesh is a mesh is a special kind of loop. And remember, a loop is a closed path. So in this circuit here, I have a loop here, I have a loop here, and then I have a loop around the outer perimeter of the circuit. Well, only this loop and this loop are meshes. Okay, see, a mesh is a special kind of loop. This perimeter loop here is not a mesh. Okay, it's a closed path, but it's not considered a mesh. So the way I determine, or I think an easy way to determine where your meshes are, is that if you imagine that the circuit is a window frame, where the panes of glass go in the window frame, that's where your meshes are. So you see, we'd have a pane of glass here, that's a mesh, and we'd have a pane of glass here, that's a mesh. So now we're going to define currents flowing in the meshes, and I'm going to define a current in this mesh that I'm going to have going clockwise that I'm going to label I1. And once I have this mesh current direction defined, I'm going to put the polarity of the voltages across the resistors due to that mesh current in here. That's going to help us write our equations coming up. And then I'm going to define another mesh current, and I'm going to change colors here. Okay, I'm going to define another mesh current over in this mesh here that I'll label I2. Okay, and again, I'm going to put in the voltage polarities for each of the voltages across the resistors due to that mesh current. So since I2 is entering this side of the 9 ohm, that's the higher end. Whoops, and I made a mistake here. Or no, I didn't make a mistake. I'm sorry, that's right. This is the higher voltage end of the 1 ohm resistor due to I2. Right, here's the higher voltage end due to I1 for the 1 ohm resistor. Okay, so we have our mesh currents. Now, I define both mesh currents going clockwise, and that's what our author does in the Alexander book. You can define mesh currents going counterclockwise, and you can also mix them up. You can have one going clockwise, one going counterclockwise, and most of the time that's going to work okay. However, there is something in this method called supermesh. Just like node voltage method had a supernode, mesh current, you'll see later on in the quarter, has something called a supermesh. And when you have a supermesh, you do want your mesh currents going the same direction. So just, I'm just going to, you know, this quarter, just keep the mesh currents going clockwise, whether I have a supermesh or not. Okay, so now we have our mesh currents defined. The problem is set up. So we're going to write a KVL equation for each of the mesh currents. So I'm going to start with KVL for I1. Okay, and it doesn't matter where you start in the mesh for your KVL as long as you come back to the same place. So I'm going to start here at the 15-volt source. As I go in the direction of mesh current I1, I'm going minus the plus in voltage across this 15 volt source. And I'm going to call that a minus quantity. So minus 15. Okay, now, still going in the direction of I1, I get to this 9 ohm resistor. Well, as I go in the direction of I1, I'm going plus to minus in voltage. So I'm going to call that a plus. And then I'm going to use Ohm's law to get that voltage across the 9. And remember, from Ohm's law, voltage is just R times I. Okay, so this is going to be 9 I1. That's the voltage across the 9 ohm due to I1. Okay, now I get to this 1 ohm resistor. Now look, there's two mesh currents defined through this 1 ohm resistor. So here's a rule of the method. Okay, remember, we said this is a systematic method of analysis, so there's some rules that we have to obey. Well, one rule is that if you have two mesh currents defined through a resistor, it's going to give you two terms in your KVL equation. Okay, now one term is going to be the following. As I'm going in the direction of I1, I'm going plus to minus in voltage across the 1 ohm resistor. So that's going to be plus 1 times I1. Okay, now I realize I could just write this as I1, but the reason I'm explicitly showing the 1 is to remind you that this is resistance times current. This term here has to be a voltage term because we're doing a KVL equation. So just to, you know, clearly show that this is a voltage term. It's resistance times current. Okay, but now we get a second term for the 1 ohm resistor, and the way we get the second term is we're still going in the direction of I1 because that's the KVL equation that we're writing, but as I go in the direction of I1, I'm going minus the plus in voltage due to I2. So you see that's going to be a minus 1 times I2. Okay, so when you have a resistor with two mesh currents defined through it, it gives you two terms in your KVL equation. Okay, now we get to the 11 volt source. As I'm going in the direction of I1, I'm going minus the plus in voltage, so that's going to be a minus 11, and then that sums to 0. Okay, so that's our KVL equation for I2. Now we have to do a KVL equation. Or excuse me, that was the KVL for I1. Now we're doing an equation for I2. Okay, so now I'm over in this mesh. Okay, so I'm going in the direction of I2. Here at the 21 volt source, I'm going minus the plus in voltage, so that's going to be a minus 21. Okay, then I get to the 11 volt source in the direction of I2. I'm going plus the minus in voltage, so that's going to be a plus 11. See, one thing to note here is that when there's two mesh currents through a resistor, it gives you two terms in the KVL. If there's two currents through a voltage source, it only gives you one term. So you see, just like we only wrote one term for the 11 volt source in this KVL, same thing here. And why is that so? Because that's one of the rules of the method. As long as you obey the rules and, you know, do the right steps and you know, do some math, you'll get the right answer. That's the whole you know, beauty of these systematic methods. Okay, now we get to the 1 ohm resistor. So going in the direction of I2, I'm going plus to minus in voltage, so that's going to be plus 1 times I2. Okay, and then also still going in the direction of I2, I'm going minus to plus in voltage across the 1 ohm, so that's going to give me minus 1 I1. And then at this 9 ohm resistor here, I'll get plus 9 I2, and then that sums to 0. Okay, so you see what I'm left with now is two equations, two unknowns. So now we just need to solve these equations. So on the next page here, I've you know, combined terms and rearranged where these are the two equations that need to be solved. And using Cramer's rule, which you should be familiar with, if you know, you've taken my advice and you've been using that to solve sim equations from node voltage method. And you can see here that mesh current I1 ends up being 2.73 amps, and mesh current I2 ends up being 1.27 amps. Now, just like in node voltage method, where once you solve the simultaneous equation and you get your answers, you should be able to go back to the circuit and find any current or any voltage or any power for any element. Same thing with this method. So here I've just redrawn the circuit. Here's the answers we came up with for our mesh currents. And now we can get every current, every voltage, every power for each of the elements in this circuit. So just some examples here. Let's say we want the current through this 9 ohm resistor right here on the left side of the circuit. Well, look, the only mesh current that's defined through that 9 ohm resistor is I1. So the current through that 9 ohm, this 9 ohm on the left side, is just I1. It's 2.73 amps. Likewise, this 9 ohm on the right side of the circuit, well, the only mesh current defined through it is I2. So its current is I2. There's 1.27 amps flowing through that resistor. Likewise, since this 15-volt source is in series with this 9, it also has 2.73 amps, right, because they're in series, and both of them only have I1 defined through them. And over here, this 9 ohm and this 21-volt source both have I2, both have 1.27 amps flowing through them. This 15-volt source is supplying power, since the current's going to be leaving the higher voltage end. And also this 21-volt source is supplying power. And you could figure out how many watts just by taking the voltage of the sources and multiplying by the current that's flowing through them. Okay, now we get to the 1-ohm resistor. Well, the 1-ohm resistor has two mesh currents defined through it. And you see one of those mesh currents is I1 that's going down through the 1-ohm. Right? I1 is going down. And I2 is going up through the 1-ohm. Okay, so to find the current for an element when there's two mesh currents going opposite directions, you just take the difference. Okay, so you see the current flowing through the 1 ohm, it's going to equal just the difference, 2.73 minus 1.27, okay, which comes out to, that's 1.46 amps. And then the direction of that current through the 1 ohm is going to be the direction of the largest mesh current value. And the largest one is I1, which is going down. So you see that 1.46 amps, it's going down through that 1 ohm resistor. And by the way, this would equal the current through the 11-volt source. All right, so that 11-volt source is also supplying power, since the current is going to be leaving the positive end of that 11-volt source. The voltage across the 1 ohm, well, that's from Ohm's law, R times I. Right, and here it's just going to be 1 times 1.46 amps, so 1.46 volts. Okay? All right, one more here. Let's say we call this node ground. Okay, let's say we decide to call this our reference node ground. And then let's say I label this node right here node A. And now I want to know what the voltage at node A is. Okay? And remember, voltages at a node are with respect to ground, unless you're told otherwise. But here, we're not told otherwise. So we want the voltage between this node and ground. Well, one way we can do that is find the voltage across this 1 ohm resistor, and then combine that voltage with this 11-volt source, and that will be the voltage across these two nodes. So, first of all, the voltage across the 1 ohm resistor we already figured out here. It's 1.46 volts. And we already figured out that the current through the 1 ohm is going down. Right? So that means the higher voltage end of that resistor is on the top, because the 1.46, the net current through the 1 ohm, is entering that higher voltage end. So you see, to get the voltage at node A, we just go, okay, well, at ground we have 0 volts. At this node right here, there's minus 11 volts. You know, if I call that node B, let's say, node B is just equal to the source value, and it's minus since the plus end, the higher end, is connected to ground. So you see B is just minus 11 volts. Okay, well now between node B, which is minus 11 volts, and node A, the node voltage we're after is this 1 ohm resistor. So as we go from this node to this node, we're changing the amount of voltage that's across the resistor, the 1.46 volts. And since this is the lower end of the 1.46 volts, and this is the higher end, as I go from node B to node A, I'm going up 1.46 volts. So you see node A is minus 11 plus 1.46 volts. Okay, and what does that come out to? That comes out to minus 9.54 volts. Okay, that's our answer for VA. Now, you should get the same answer no matter what path we take between ground and node A. See, we took this path that involves the 11 volt source and the 1 ohm resistor. But if I take this path between ground and node A, the one that involves the 15 volt source and this 9 ohm resistor, I should get the same answer. And if I go this direction, okay, I should get the same answer. See, the voltage between two nodes in a circuit does not depend on the path you take. Again, it's analogous to the surface height analogy that we've used in previous classes, that you know, you can think of voltage at a node as a surface height. Well, if you climb Bishop's Peak, let's say, you're going to have the same potential energy once you get to the top of Bishop's Peak, no matter what path you take to get there, right? That potential energy you have does not depend on the path taken. Well, it's the same thing in circuits between nodes, that the electric potential, the voltage between those two nodes, is not dependent on path. Okay, well, we'll be doing several more problems using this mesh current method, because we haven't seen all the rules yet.